All right, so good morning, everybody. Welcome to lecture 21, quantum mechanics part one. Now, Priya just asked a very nice question, which is that if you are saying that according to our time evolution equation, the future state depends on the past state, it's related to it by some unitary operator, right? Then if you reverse that, you get that the past state is given by the future state multiplied by the inverse of the unitary operator, right? So I think Priya's question is how is that possible? How does the future determine the past? Is that correct? Priya, am I stating your?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, well, first of all, at a technical level, in classical mechanics also, you have your equations of motion, right? So the equations of motion, so what you're talking about, right, is basically the idea of time reversal symmetry. Right. So quantum mechanics, the standard formulation of quantum mechanics is reversible under, is symmetric under time reversal, right? So what that means is that if t goes to minus t, the equations of motion don't change, right? But in classical mechanics also that's true, right? In classical mechanics also I can take t to minus t, right? So if I have a two body problem, right? I have one object orbiting another object, right? And you give me the position and momentum of this object at some point here, right? Then at some later point, I can determine its position and momentum. If I know the initial space coordinates, right? So let me call this p1, x1. But then I can also go back, right? I can trace the history, retrace the history backwards also. Yeah. So the way to view this, right, in classroom mechanics, is that you think of your phase space. Okay, this is our phase space. Let's say this is the momentum coordinate and this is the position coordinate. Right? And this is the phase space at some instant of time. Okay? At time t is equal to constant. And our system is described by a point in this phase space, right? This is how we describe a systems in classical mechanics, right? If you give me the phase space, a single point in the phase space gives me the configuration of all the particles and momenta, right? So in general, this will be like some multi-dimensional variable, right? So this is a very like, this is not some two-dimensional space, it's some n-dimensional space, right? So as time goes on, what happens, right? As time progresses, this point, it moves around, it evolves to another point, right? Right? And what happens in the past also? In the past, you started off at some other point, and your evolution led you to this point. Right? So this is P2 comma X2, P0 comma X0, P1 comma X1. Now, time flows both ways. The evolution of this system is symmetric in time, right? For example, if you have a freely moving particle, the Hamiltonian is given by this, right? Classical particle. So what is the equation of motion, right? X is equal to X0, right? Some initial condition plus PT by M, right? But now you can ask, what is the, how is the position related to the present position? How is the past position related? And you know the answer to that, right? I mean, you know that you can trace the time evolution in any other direction, right? Right. Similarly, if you consider some other system, like you consider a pool table, right? So you have some billiard ball, right, on your table, and it moves in this direction, like this. Then it goes here, like this, right? Right. So you can also start at some later time, right? And you can trace the evolution backwards also, no? Right? So you can go either this way or you can go this way. Now, what we see in nature is not like that, right? Nature appears to be time asymmetric, right? Because you look around you, you see that there is a flow of time, right? From what we call the past to the future, right? But still, the laws of motion are time symmetric, right? Whether the classical ones or the quantum ones. So then the question is, right? How does B imply A, right? How does this asymmetric evolution that we see around us, how does that come from the microscopic evolution, which is time reversal symmetry, right? So for example, if you look at if you have a cup of coffee, you will, what will be the, what will you expect to happen? You will expect the temperature of the coffee to cool down, right? You won't expect the reverse to happen. You, right? I mean, but if you ask the, if you say that the laws of motion are symmetric on a micro scale, right? Each individual particle doesn't really care whether it's going forward or backward in time. Then why is it not possible that the molecules could move in such a way that the cup of coffee starts to gain energy instead of losing energy? Why does that not happen? Right? So many people say that the reason for this is thermodynamics, right? The law of entropy. The second law of thermodynamics says that entropy always increases, right? So if you look at a big enough system like a cup of coffee, which has many, many, many degrees of freedom, it will always evolve in phase space, right? So this is the phase space of my coffee cup. Okay. And now there are, you know, trillions of atoms in this coffee cup. And let's say that all the atoms have some energy and momenta initially, which is all in some region, some compact region of the phase space, okay? Now, what happens to this collection of points, right? What happens to this collection of points as time evolves? What happens is that this collection of points, it spreads out in the phase space. Why does it do that? Because there is so much empty volume in the phase space. Right? And so when it spreads out, the entropy of the system increases. A few videos would be very, very good, helpful. If any of you need a sort of data, please tell me. I'll top up your mobile account. So, otherwise, please. I realize that you have family members going in and out, sometimes not entirely fully dressed also. But that's okay, don't worry about it, okay? I mean, Zoom, it's COVID, nobody cares about such things anymore, right? So it is overwhelmingly more likely that this system of particles will spread out in phase space than for the reverse to happen. But if you look at each individual trajectory, right, if you look at each individual trajectory, this trajectory is time symmetric. Each individual trajectory is time symmetric, but collectively, their collective motion leads to a spreading out in the space. Right. So this is a statement about statistics, something called the law of large numbers. So when you ask that why, if you have a quantum system, right? And you have P1 is greater than P is greater than P2. Then you ask, well, why does this happen? Right? Why is it time reversal symmetry? Well, at a technical level, it is time reversal symmetric because that's what the equation of motion, they are also time reversal symmetric, right? So if you can write psi of p is some unitary operator, psi of p1 is some unitary operator, right? Then you can just act with the inverse of this unitary operator on both sides. And if you act with the inverse of this unitary operator on both sides, you will get this, right? One is backwards, so to speak, quote unquote, backwards, and another is forward. But both are equally valid. Okay? Now, there are many systems in which time reversal symmetry is violated at a microscopic level also. So time permitting, we will discuss such systems later in the course. Okay? So I don't know if I've given you a satisfactory answer or not. Okay? But the simple one-line answer is that the equations of motion are time symmetric. So the future states can affect the past states also. But there is one thing in quantum theory which is not time symmetric. What is that? That is the concept of measurement, right? So what happens? So if you want to get some information from a quantum system, we have a quantum system at some time t. Panchami, do you have a question? Okay. You have a quantum system at some time t and you make a measurement, right? You measure some operator A. It's a Hermitian operator. This operator has some eigenstates. Right? So your psi of t can be written as these eigenstates, they form a complete orthogonal set, right? So any state in the vector space can be written as a linear sum of these eigenstates. But what happens when you perform a measurement? When you perform a measurement, your state collapses, right? It collapses either into phi1 or phi2. You don't know which one it collapses into, right? This is a non-deterministic process, right? This is not a deterministic process. And when once it collapses, can you go back? Can you go back? You can't go back, right? For an individual quantum system, like let's say I have a spin 1/2 system, right, and I measure the z component of the spin, then the collapse, it collapses into either the up state or a down state with a probability alpha squared and with a probability beta squared, right? But see, these probabilities are determined by taking the statistics of a large number of events, right? Right, you can't determine the probability from a single event. So in a single event, right, in a single event when there is a collapse, so if I go from here, there's a single collapse, right? Can I determine what was alpha, what was beta? I can't, right? So measurement, right? This is the process of measurement. And measurement is a time asymmetric process. Right, because collapse only happens in one direction. You can't decollapse the system. Okay, so in this sense, quantum mechanics does have an inbuilt time asymmetry. Right. So I can always take a state in the past and relate it to a state in the future. But can I say that a measurement happens in the past and a collapse happens in the past? I don't know. I think people have worked on such ideas, but I don't know enough about it to talk about it. Okay. So if you're satisfied with all of this information, then I'll move on to the next thing.
Yes, sir. Got it, sir.
Okay. Okay. So now we'll continue with this thing. We'll continue talking about time evolution of operators. And so what we saw was that in the Heisenberg picture, an operator at some later time t is given by this time evolution adjoint right, and if you so this is t prime is state as infinity, right? And you can also write down a equation of motion, right? You can derive this from the first statement. Okay, so we can look at some simple cases. Let's look at a free particle, right? What is the Hamiltonian? E square by 2m, right? We can also add some, well, let me not put in any momentum for the time being, okay? Now, I can ask, how does this operator, how does the momentum operator change with time? So first of all, let me ask, how does the expectation value of the operator change? Okay. So let me work in the Schrodinger picture first. So in the Schrodinger picture, I have my state, right? I have my state psi, and I can write any state as e to the I kx, like this, right? So this is a state with some momentum k. Okay, I can ask what is the expectation value of p in this state. Right. What will I get? The expectation value will just turn out to be equal to h bar k. So whenever I say check and homework, that means that's a homework to check it. Right. Now, how does this expectation value change in time, right? It doesn't change, it's constant, right? And that's what I expect. I expect this to be the case, no? I expect the momentum to not change because it's a free particle. It will just move along some trajectory, classically, right? But I can also ask what is the expectation value of the of the position operator, right? So again, I'll leave this for you as a homework. Now, I can ask, well, how does this expectation value depend on time, right? So I, like I said, the momentum expectation value doesn't change, right? But let me make sure that is the case. So if I want to evaluate the momentum expectation value at some later time, at some time t, what do? I look at my state in the Schrodinger picture at some later time t, right? And this is how I evaluate it. So now let me ask what happens to my state at some later time t. Right. So what is the state? This state is, what is it given by? It's given by this unitary operator minus I by h bar t. I take my initial time to be zero, just to keep things simple. Okay. This unitary operator acts on e to the I kx on this state. Okay. Now instead of working with the full vector with all this bracket notation, I can also just work with the components. So I'll just do that. So this will act on IKS, right? Now, what is this action of this object on exponent IKX? So this e to the IKX, this is an eigenstate of the momentum operator, right? If I take the momentum operator and I act on this, what do I get? I get minus, so let me see, the momentum operator is minus I by h bar, I'm sorry, let's put it minus I h bar d by ds, right? E to the ik, right? So I get I minus, that cancels out, I get h bar k e to the ik, right? So what does psi of k of t acting on this exponent ikx give me? Well, it just gives me, instead of h, I can just write down the eigenvalue of h, right? Because this is an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian, right? So what is my Hamiltonian action on this operator? My Hamiltonian is minus h bar squared by 2m d squared by dx squared e to the ik, right? What do I get? I get h bar squared k squared by 2m. So my psi k of t, what does it become? It becomes exponent minus I h bar t, and then whenever I see the h hat, I can put the eigenvalue instead. I forgot to write. And so the eigenvalue is h squared k squared by 2m. Okay. Time e to the ik. All right, now this factor, it doesn't depend on x. So it is independent of the position variable, right? So if I calculate the expectation value of the momentum at a later time t in the Schrodinger picture, what do I get? Psi kt, right? But now this derivative d by dx, when it acts on psi of k, it won't have any effect on the first, when this derivative acts on psi of k, it won't have any effect on this exponential, right? Because the exponential doesn't depend on the position. So what will happen when I do this? When I do this, so I will get one factor of this exponential from my ket psi. I'll get one factor of this exponential with a positive sign in the exponent from the bracket. And those two will just cancel out, right? E to the I theta times e to the minus I theta is just one. So I will be left with, when I do this evaluation, I'll be left with just psi k at the original time, p hat psi k 0, which will give me, which is equal to my original momentum h. Right? Now this is in the Schrodinger picture. I can do the same thing in the Heisenberg picture. Okay, so in the Heisenberg picture, I have a momentum, but now this momentum operator depends on time, right? And this momentum operator, how is it related to the momentum operator at some previous time? It is related by multiplication by this unitary operator times p at some zero and times this. Okay. Right, but now you can ask, so if you look at this expression, what do you have? You have that the Hamiltonian commutes with the momentum, right? So since the Hamiltonian commutes with the momentum, I can just take this exponential and put it to the other side of the momentum operator. I can just take the exponential and put it to the other side because of this, of the fact that they come in. And this just gives me one. Right? So this tells me that my momentum operator is also a constant in time. That is what I expect, right? Discrete particle is obviously the most simple system. Okay. And I'm working with momentum eigenstate. So here's one thing, see, is very important to understand this. In the Schrodinger picture, I was working with the quantum state, individual quantum state, right? And then I asked, what is the time dependence of that state? And then I evaluated the expectation value of the momentum operator in that state. In the Heisenberg picture, I ask what is the time dependence of the operator, right? And my state doesn't change in time, right? So my state, it remains this right, whatever state I choose, right, these coefficients I can choose them to be whatever I want, right? Here I've taken this to be a plane wave, but I can pick some other set of coefficients also. Right, so the expectation value of the momentum in this Heisenberg picture is psi p of p psi, but now since p of p doesn't is just equal to p naught, I will just get the same expression as before, right? Nothing changes. Right. So this is obviously a very simple system, which doesn't seem that interesting, right? So let's you have class at 9, I suppose.
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, then I'll stop here for today, because I won't be able to complete the next part. So, but I'll tell you what we will look at next. We'll look at the something called a Gaussian state. Right. So this state right now is not it's a plane wave. It has fixed momentum. So if I look at the if I look at these coefficients of this state, right? These coefficients are a function of x, right? So I can, this is what? This is psi of x. So psi of x, what is it? It looks like a, well, it's a complex number. So, but if I look at the real components and the imaginary component separately, right? It's a plane wave like this, right? And I can, now what I can do is I can also look in the same, at the same state, I can transform it into the momentum representation. How do I do that? I take a Fourier transform of this expression. So when I look at the momentum representation, what is psi of p going to look like? It's going to be zero everywhere. And it's a delta function at a single point. At which point? At this point where p is equal to the value of the momentum over here. Right. So this is what a free particle looks like. It is maximally spread out in position space. Sorry, this is what a momentum eigenstate looks like. And in momentum space, it is like a delta function. Similarly, if I ask what is a, this is a momentum eigenstate. Similarly, I can ask what happens to a position eigenstate. So I'll write this as a momentum eigenstate. A position eigenstate is what? How do I think of this position eigenstate? I can write it like this: delta x minus x prime get x prime d. This is psi of x. So in position space, in the position representation, my eigenstate of the position operator is just a delta function, maximally peaked around one point. So let me put this as x naught over here, right? But what will it look like in momentum space? So in momentum space, I will get, if I do the Fourier transform of this delta function, what will I get? I'll get plane wave. So I'll get something like this. Okay. So if I write this in position space, sorry, in momentum space, the same thing will look like this. E to the I k x naught k d. Right. So this is the momentum space coefficient. Right. So this is a position eigenstate. And momentum eigenstate. In the position representation, the momentum eigenstate looks like this. E to the I k naught x at x dx. And in the momentum representation, well, it's just a delta function. Right. Now, what I can instead of having such something like this, I can have something called a Gaussian state. So a Gaussian state looks like the following. Okay. Psi, and it depends on two parameters, x naught and alpha. And it looks like this. Exponent minus x naught square over 2 alpha square get x. Dx. So if you look at this state, we look at the components of this state in the position basis. What do they look like? It looks like it's called a bell curve. Right? It has some mean value. That mean value is given by this x naught. And it has some width. And that width is given by the parameter alpha. Now this Gaussian state has a special property that when I perform a Fourier transform of this Gaussian state to get the momentum component, in momentum space also, a Gaussian state looks the same. It has the same shape. So anyways, in our next class, we'll talk about how does a Gaussian, so this is a wave packet now, right? So we'll talk about how a wave packet is evolved. Okay. All right. Okay, so I'll stop here. Okay, see if you have any questions. Otherwise, you're of course free to leave. Okay, bye bye. And let me just say that look, all of this is fine if you come to class, you listen to all the lectures. But if you don't sit down and work this out on your own, nothing will stay here. Okay. So wherever I say homework and check and so on and so forth, you should do that. Okay. All right. I'll see you all on Monday. Okay. Bye bye.
Okay. Thank you, sir.